back to microbial concepts. Today we are going to discuss about siderophore detection. Already one video is uploaded on my channel for just siderophores, which covers the basic concept, then some examples and types of siderophores. Okay, so this video we will just discuss about detection methods for these siderophores. Okay, so let's start with that. So just we will have a basic idea and we will just revise about siderophores here. Okay, so what is siderophore? So actually it is a high affinity ion chelating compound. Okay, so what does chelation means? It means the siderophore will go in the nearby environment when bacteria secrete this particular compound, and the compound will find for free ion. Okay, so it will go and bind to that particular ion molecule and it will just provide that back to the bacterial cell. Okay, so that is the main function of siderophores in simple words. It will just go and sequester the ion molecule and it will go back to the bacterial cell and it will provide the ion. So the siderophore compound or these molecules, they have low molecular weight and they are small in size. Okay, the molecular weight ranges from 500 to 1000 Daltons. They are secreted by bacteria, fungi and different grasses. Okay, so why these living cells, they produce or they secrete siderophores? So we know that iron is very essential for all living organisms and it is involved in various metabolic pathways. Correct. The aerobic atmosphere of the planet has caused the surface iron to oxidize into insoluble hydroxide polymer. Okay, what is the result of oxidation? The iron has got converted into insoluble hydroxide polymer and the level of free iron is reduced. Correct. So the free iron is not sufficiently available for these microorganisms. Okay, so in such conditions, what microorganism does? It just uses such kind of systems like siderophores to have a sufficient uptake of iron from the environment. Okay, that is the reason why bacteria or fungi or grasses, they produce and they secrete siderophores into their nearby environment. Right, so why to study this? If you have a soil sample, say you are planning a project or you are having a practical exam and you are given an unknown sample, then you should be able to find out whether there are some bacteria or fungi which are able to produce and secrete siderophores. Okay, so how you will do that? You need to know some detection methods. Correct. So these are detection methods that today we are going to discuss, and from that solid CAS medium is the widely used qualitative method for just detection of the siderophores. Okay, others are quantitative methods. Okay, other three are quantitative methods, but this is the qualitative method that to just have an idea that whether your isolate is producing a siderophore or not. Okay, so these are four methods that we are going to discuss in today's video. So this is my reference. This is actually a very good article. Okay, and if you want to have more details, just Google out this name of the research article, and it is really, really very helpful. Okay, you will get to know everything about siderophore detection here. I had referred the same, and all the rights are reserved to the author here. Okay, so this is another reference for the actual CAS core paper. Okay, blue agar paper, it is also called as blue agar paper, and it was written in 1987. Okay, so you can also have a look on this. You should know about the original paper for your practical exams. Okay, so that's why I had included this. Okay, so about CAS assay. So this is the solid plate detection method. So these are some examples. So if you have a practical exam, you have questions like what is the color change, or what are the examples, can you give some examples of siderophore producing bacteria, then you should be able to give at least four examples. Pseudomonas is very active siderophore producer. Okay, then Azotobacter, Bacillus, some species of Bacillus, then Streptomyces, Serratia, Enterobacter, Azospirillum, and Rhizobium. Okay, so these are examples, and here you can see there are two plates shown. So the first one is siderophore producer. Okay, so the color of CAS medium is actually bluish, and if you streak your isolate, then you may get either of these pictures, okay, or images. The first one is the producer, where you will see there is a color change, that is blue to orange, but in case of non-producers there is no color change, correct? There is no color change in case of non-producers. Okay, you will just see bacterial growth. Okay, so chrome azurol sulfonate method. So we will just go through the principle first, okay, and then we will see about the preparation and other procedures. So Fe3, it gives the agar a rich blue color, and concentration of siderophores excreted by iron star organisms result into the color change. Okay, that is the, in simple words, that is the principle. HDTMA is used as detergent, and its concentration is crucial to successful growth and testing of bacteria. Okay, so this is the detergent which we use, a type of detergent which we use in our medium. If the concentration is too low, the blue color will precipitate, and if it is too high, the bacteria will die. Okay, and that's why HDTMA, the concentration of this detergent should be proper. Okay, it is very crucial. HDTMA is a cationic detergent that is added to CAS agar to stabilize the FeCAS indicator. Okay, so CAS is the chrome azurol sulfonate. Okay, so when Fe is bound to it, it will give a blue color. Okay, and when bacteria grows on the media and it secretes the siderophores, the Fe will get separated from the CAS indicator, and thus the indicator will turn into the orange color. Okay, so when Fe is bound to CAS, you will have blue color, and once it is bound to the siderophore, you will have orange color. Okay, that is the principle here. And an orange halo is observed around the siderophore producing colony because the siderophore chelates the iron and removes it from the dye complex. Okay, thus this is a qualitative test. Okay, so let's move towards medium preparation. So here we use King's B medium generally. Okay, so 35 ml of CAS reagent plus 100 ml of King's agar medium. Both should be autoclaved separately and then mixed to prepare CAS agar medium. Okay, so this is about the pleat. Now about the CAS reagent, it should be freshly prepared. The solutions listed below should be mixed in the following order. And okay, so if you don't have idea about CAS reagent preparation, then this may help you out. Okay, so you need to have four solutions, that is solution A, B, D and C. Everything, the details are given here. Okay, so solution C has point that should be 10 ml, and from that how to prepare that, 0.03 ml of HCl is added in 100 ml of distilled water. Okay, from that you will need max 10 ml. Then you need solution D, that is 100 ml. How to make that? So you need to add ferric chloride, that is 0.026 grams in 100 ml distilled water. Okay, so you need this 100 ml solution whole. Then solution B, that is 50 ml, so you need CAS dye, that is 0.06 grams to be dissolved in 50 ml of distilled water. And solution A, which is our detergent, that is HDTMA, that is hexadecyl trimethyl ammonium bromide. Okay, so you need to dissolve 0.07 grams of HDTMA in 40 ml of distilled water. Okay, so In this order, you need to dissolve everything, okay, to get the proper CS reagent. Okay, so the end product or the solution will be 200 ml of blue colored CAS reagent. Okay, so you can add up 10 plus 100 is 110, 110 plus 50 is 160 plus 40 is 200 ml. So you will get a 200 ml of colored blue colored CAS reagent. Okay, so of that you may need 35 ml for making 100 ml of King's B. You will add that 200 ml of King's B or King's A medium, okay, whichever your professors or teachers they recommend you. Both of these are actually used to have pigment reduction, okay, for Pseudomonas species. So most of the times you will find that a star culture from the King's B agar or King's B broth is strict over CAS medium. Okay, so the King's B will just it will help to induce the pigment production, okay, or cedar for production, because the medium does not have iron. Okay, so the bacteria will secrete that to get the iron. Okay, so that is the starved culture which you may directly used for your CAS agar plates. Okay, that will also do. So the King's B agar medium composition is also given here to for your reference purpose. Okay, so for example, you are having a Pseudomonas culture. So enrichment of Pseudomonas in King's B medium, that is broth, is done. It is enriched in sterile King's B medium at room temperature for 24 hours on shaker. The broth is then kept for stationary for 1 day, okay, at room temperature. Enriched Pseudomonas aeruginosa was then strict on sterile CAS agar plate, and then it was incubated at 37 degrees Celsius for 24 hours. Then you will see, or you will observe, an orange to red hollow indicated production of the siderophores. Okay, so this was about solid CAS medium method, right? Now we will be moving towards quantitative methods, and the first one is CAS shuttle assay. Okay, so here also you will be using CAS solution, but there is one more thing that you will be adding, okay, and that is the sulfosalicylic acid. Okay, that is the shuttling solution. Okay, so this is the liquid assay, right? So the cultures were grown in minimal medium. Okay, so minimal medium which lacks the Fe is used for the growth of the culture for say 37 degrees Celsius at for 24 hours at 37 degrees Celsius. Okay, under static conditions as well as under shaker condition, say 100 rpm at 37 degrees Celsius for 24 hours. The cells were removed by centrifugation at 3000 rpm for 15 minutes, and 0.5 ml of the culture supernatant. Okay, so after centrifugation you will use culture supernatant. You are not using cells, bacterial cells. You don't want bacterial cells, you want culture supernatant. And this culture supernatant 0.5 ml is then mixed with 0.5 ml of CAS solution, 1:1 volume by volume. Okay, and to that you need to add 10 microliters of shuttling solution. Okay, 10 microliters of shuttling solution, that is sulfosalicylic acid. The color obtained was determined using the spectrophotometer at 630 nanometers after 20 minutes of incubation. Okay, so you need to give some incubation time to let your CAS solution and sulfosalicylic acid solution react, and to get a color change. Okay, because you are going to determine the color change by spectrophotometer at 630 nanometers. Okay, so you will, what you will do, you will estimate the loss of blue color to orange. Okay, so here in the image you can see there is a control, there is Fe deficient culture, and there is Fe plus, means Fe has been chelated by the siderophore. Okay. So what you will need? Necessary blank. Obviously, when you are determining it by spectrophotometer, you need a blank, which will be your minimal media, and then reference solution, which will be minimal media plus CS dye plus shuttle solution. Okay, this we are used during determination. So this is the formula, that is AR minus AS divided by AR into 100. So this will give you percentage of siderophore produced. Okay, so where AR is the absorbance at 630 nanometers of reference, and AS is the absorbance at 360 nanometers of the sample. Okay, so this figure 4, it shows the result of siderophore detection in the fungus Piriformospora indica using this CS shuttle assay. Okay, so Fe minus is Fe deficient culture or broth. Fe plus is Fe sufficient, where the siderophore has bound to the Fe, and the C is the reference sample. Okay, so this is about the shuttle assay, and this is the quantitative method. Okay, so by using this particular formula, you can determine in percentage that how much siderophore is been produced. Next is Sackey's assay for the detection of hydroxymide siderophore. Okay, so because different microbes, they produce different types of siderophores, with some capable of producing more than one type of siderophore at the same time, and as the CS assay is limited by its non-specificity. So this is the disadvantage of CS assay. It has non-specificity. Okay, you cannot determine each and every type of siderophore. Okay, or it cannot differentiate between that between different types of siderophores. Okay, so other assays are needed that are able to distinguish between different siderophores. So the Sackey's assay is quantitative for hydroxymic acids. Okay, so hydroxymide siderophore is another type, correct? So for that particular siderophore, you may use Sackey's assay, and is thus needed to detect and quantify hydroxymide siderophore such as desferrioxamines. Okay, in the procedure, you will require equal volumes of culture supernatant and acid, that is H2SO4 of 6 molars. They are mixed and autoclaved at 121 degrees Celsius for 30 minutes. Okay, and upon cooling, you will add 1 ml of acid iodine solution, that is sulfanilic acid, and then prepared in acetic acid. Okay, so the acid iodine solution is prepared in acetic acid. Plus, you will add 0.5 ml of iodine, okay, and you will mix this. This mixture is then incubated for 5 minutes at room temperature, and after which excess iodine, if it is present in your solution, it is removed by adding 1 ml of trisodium arsenate. Okay, so what is the role of trisodium arsenate? It is used to remove excess iodine in your solution. Subsequently, a 1 ml solution of alpha naphthylamine, which is prepared in acetic acid, is also added. Okay, so this is about the Sackey's assay. So the color of the solution at this point would change from orange to red. Okay, so the final volume can be raised to 10 ml by adding distilled water, that is DH2O, which means distilled water, to bring the solution to a measurable range if the red color is too intense. Okay, if the red color is too intense, then to have your reading traceable on your standard graph, you need to dilute your sample. Okay, if it is too intense, otherwise if the one which you can see here in the figure, you can just use this. Okay, this color is also fine. The absorbance can be measured at 526 nanometer after 30 minutes at room temperature. So here also you need to give some incubation time to get your all reagents, your solutions react properly. Okay, purified desferoxamine or hydroxyl amine hydrochloride red color in solution can be used as standard. Okay, so to plot a graph, you may use any one of these as your sample. An example of results of Sackey's assay is shown in figure 5. So detection of hydroxymethane solution in Fe deficient culture. Okay, so there is no iron present. Okay, so the filtrate is this Fe deficient orange color. Okay, the light red color of the Fe minus treatment is indicative of the presence of hydroxymethane like compound. Okay, so there is some presence. Okay, no red color, hence no siderophores. So here there is no this negative control means there is no red color, means there is no siderophore production. Okay, uninoculated SIM, that is the minimal culture. Okay, and the hydroxyl amine were used as the negative and positive standard controls respectively. Okay, so that is the, this is the original siderophore which is used as standard. Okay, and this is the negative control. Okay, so here there is no siderophore produced, and here there is siderophore produced, there, that's why you are having a color change. Okay, so this is about Sackey's assay. Now let's move towards Arnau's assay for detection of catechol-like type of siderophores. Okay, it is based on the fact that catechol, which when combined with the nitrous oxide, that is HNO2, gives off a yellow color. The yellow color is transformed to red, orange red in the presence of excess of NaOH. Okay, so this is the principle of Arnau's method. In this method, filtrates, that is 1 ml from the Fe deficient culture, are added to 1 ml of 0.5 molar HCl. Okay, at this stage the solution should be colorless. Okay, so we had added the filtrate, that is supernatant, from the Fe deficient culture to the 1 ml of 0.5 molar HCl. So there is no color. The mixture is then shaken briefly, and 1 ml of nitrate molybdate reagent, that is 10 gram of sodium nitrate plus 10 gram of sodium molybdate, which are dissolved in 100 ml of distilled water. Okay, they are added. Okay, the presence of catechol-like type of siderophore in the sample is indicated by the transformation of the yellow color. Okay, so now you will see a yellow color. Next, 1 ml of 1 molar NaOH solution is added, and the mixture is incubated at the room temperature for 5 minutes. After incubation, the solution should become reddish in color. The quantification is then performed by measuring the absorbance of the mixture at 510 nanometers using the spectrophotometer. Okay, so you can see there is color change. Okay, so Fe deficient, Fe minus, is the filtrate which we used from streptomyces culture. Okay, that is used, and when you add other reagents, when you allow that particular filtrate to react, okay, then you will see there is a yellowish color. Okay, then you add 1 molar NaOH 1 ml, and then you will see there is more intense color form that detects the, and that confirms the presence of siderophore. Okay, catechol-like type of siderophore. So in this given photo here, or the picture, you will see there is standard, which is lightly reddish in color. Then there is sample. Okay, and then there is blank. Okay, for quality control, commercially obtained catechol and uninoculated Fe deficient growth mediums are used as positive and negative controls respectively. The quantity of siderophores can be estimated by using pure catechol to generate a standard curve. Okay, that is in all other methods as well. You need to generate a standard curve, and then you can plot your measurements or your results from spectrophotometer, and then you can quantify. Okay, so this was about our NOES assay, and we had completed our topic here. Okay, so thank you for watching, and like, share and subscribe to my channel. Okay, don't forget to follow me on Instagram and Facebook as well with the same handle, that is Microbial Concept. Okay, till then, bye bye.